Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are back with the final panel discussion on the last segment at the retail real estate at IRF 2018. The topic of discussion is going to be on the lines of the big revolution in leasing of malls, leasing practices which are at the heart of the most successful malls of tomorrow. Some of the questions this panel discussion is aiming to answer is things like, how's the world of leasing changing around us? Is it the time to find a leasing solution to accommodate all mix of brands? International retailers versus Indian retailers, preferential treatment, lease terms, zoning allotment, long leases versus short leases, long leases versus sales throughout international retailers, what is their growth potential? What kind of approach are we going to follow? Are we going to follow one shoe fits all or customization? Because every retailer has a different need. And just when customer experiences have become the most important facet in retail for the final shopper, what are we doing to make retailer experience and onboarding into a mall more delightful experience for the retailer? And finally, who needs it more? What to do when the retailer needs the shopping center more, or when the shopping center needs the retailer most? Case in example is Uniqlo. So to answer all these questions in the facets of retail real estate, we have an esteemed panel members who are going to answer all these questions and share their eclectic experiences with you. To facilitate this discussion, may I have the pleasure of calling on stage our moderator, Mr. Mayank Saxena, MD, Land and Head, South India Residential Services and Arok Property Consultants. Can we give a big round of applause for Mr. Saxena? And for the panel members, I'd like to call on stage Mr. Sanjeev Rao, Director, Sales and Business Development, Raymond. Mr. Sanjeev Rao. Mr. Lalit Jain, VP Property and Project and Planning, Spencer's Retail. Welcome, Mr. Lalit. Can we also have on stage Mr. R. A. Shah, Property Head, Trent? Mr. R. A. Shah, Property Head, Trent. Mr. Shibu Phillips, Business Head, Lulu Mall. Mr. Phillips, if we can have you on stage, please. Ladies and gentlemen, please give them a big round of applause. We also have Mr. S. Raghunandan. Can we have him on stage? Mr. Sanjeev Mehra, VP and Head, Quest Properties India. Mr. Abhishek Bansal, Executive Director, Pacific Development Corporation Limited. And what are we waiting for? Our illustrious set of panel members are ready. Let's get this discussion started, sir.
Thank you very much. So after almost 15, 16 years, I think so again, the discussions on leasing strategy are now the retailers and the mall developers together or not? And here we are. So I think so somewhere, I don't know why, this panel is a little lopsided towards Sanjeev Mehra. You know, Sanjeev, physically Sanjeev and, you know, Mr. Shah has occupied the heavier seats. So I would like to start with Mr. Shah. So, sir, you have seen, you know, the whole journey in last 18, 20 years, and you've seen the journey moving, shifting from, you know, developer, pro-developer side to pro-retailer side, and probably where do you see the space right now?
Looks like we have to move together. It's not that developer and the retailer are different, because important is to make customer experience for both of us and see that we both make good money out of it, whatever we do, as simple as that. It's not a retailer versus developer. That's not a debate.
So negotiation life has become easy for you as a retailer and a developer, I must say?
Not that way. But basically, it's important to move together and do the better for customer, and we both earn money. That should be the idea.
Thank you on that. So Abhishek, you as a developer, I think you've seen the full cycle. So where you have done strata sale, you've done leasing, probably now doing MG revenue shares, or even zero MG pure revenue shares. Where do you see the market moving forward now in the leasing space?
I think the market is moving towards a more collaborative approach. Over the years, we've learned, we've kind of figured out what we are doing. Sale kya hota hai, per square foot kya hota hai, TD kya hota hai, ye sab pehle developer ko pata hi nahi tha. Idea bhi nahi tha, poochta bhi nahi tha. Pehle hum yehi poochte the, rent kitna dene wale ho, bas. So I think all of these learnings put together, it has translated into a more collaborative approach. And now we actually discuss what the future of the store is going to be, how we are going to open the store, how what the mix is going to be, size kya hoga, optimum size kya, all of these learnings. So I think both retailer and developer are in it to make money together, and no one person can make money in isolation. So I think that approach is really the future.
And what do you think with the incoming retailers coming in with online and international?
So online is still pretty small in terms of the total market size. In fact, organized retail is only very small of the total market size. So online is still very, very small. So, and hence you see the every year growth seems substantial, but the really the number is very low right now compared to the full market size. So that again, I would say, is a more collaborative approach from brick and mortar and online. Everybody started talking about omnicommerce, and that is precisely the reason that jab tak brick and mortar and online collaborate nahi karenge, even online will not be able to be successful.
Thank you. The collaboration is the key.
Something, the combined organized retail and online is only 8 to 10%, and 7% market is growing. So it's a good chance for everyone, and there's a good scope for everyone to grow. So it's not brick mortar versus online or other thing. The way customer evolved, we have to change. So there's a big opportunity in India to go up to 50-60%.
Interesting. So imagine for last 10-15 years, we've been hearing the space to, you know, ideally reach a level of 15 or 18 or 20%, and we still are at 8 to 10%. So I think it's a long way to go. So Lalit, you know, taking it from your side, hopefully you guys operate in probably the most difficult space in retail. And, you know, as I understand and as the market understands, hypermarket has been a difficult space, you know, to take space and operate. What has been your experience now going forward when you see huge amount of collaboration happening from mall developers, as Abhishek says?
So, thanks for recognizing the challenges with hypermarket, Mayank. So, I'm sure you'll be able to help us and all the more going forward. And, you know, to share my side, I think Abhishek has said everything that is happening right now. So it's collaborative approach. So nobody can win in isolation. It's, that's the, you know, new mantra which everybody is following. So there is nothing different that I can share or anybody else can share. I think the discussion can end there. But yes, as far as the approach is concerned, the retailer side approach is concerned, which is also pretty much the same as, you know, the developer side. Both of them are looking at their model which can give each other comfort to operate in the long run. So the short run games have all gone, I guess. And I remember, you know, the time where people used to ask for very long lock-in kind of period and all of that. People realize that it doesn't work. You can't force anybody to, you know, stay in a premise if it is not working. They'll have to mutually find workable solution for each other, and that's only way to, you know, survive. That's exactly what is happening, and happy to see, you know, developers like, you know, a couple of them are sitting right here on the panel. And that's exactly are the kind of developer who are succeeding in the market. Rest of them are still, you know, there are still some retailers who are still, the developers who are still looking at, you know, the fixed number, this is what I get, what you do is your problem. But I'm not sure, you know, how long will that approach will take them.
Thank you on that, Lalit. So Shibu, you wear two hats, one as a developer, one as a, you know, retailer, and probably a predominant very large retailer for everybody in India to, you know, accept and digest. How do you see, you know, leasing your malls going forward, and what do you, how do you see, you know, getting spaces for your brands inside the malls now?
Our strategy has been simple. We want to make destination properties, in Kerala, when we developed this property, it's become a destination for the entire state. So people travel down, and so when you are talking about destination, then you have to ensure that you give everything, representation of every category he's there, and you ensure that the best in the category is always there. Obviously, that requires you to speak to the, you understand the retail in detail. So you understand their numbers, you try to understand, are they the best in that part of the city? So what also we could, had to do in Kerala was we had to actually go and convince many retailers that Kerala is the right place for them to come. So almost 68 brands opened their first store in Kerala. So when they had to open the first store, they needed a lot of hand-holding. And we did that. We gave them comfort in that. Secondly, what has happened with us is because we are a retailer, we also ensure that our brands, which almost occupy close to 40 to 45% of the space, we do a lot of things to drive in footfalls to the malls. So today as a mall, we get an average of around 78,000 people daily. We do things. So what happens here is a retailer is very happy that as a mall developer, for their retail sustainability, they're getting so many footfalls. They just have to ensure that they collaborate, they do things in the right for themselves to get my brands. And also, infrastructure-wise, we keep adding things to our mall. So when we opened our mall, we realized that if we had more parking, it will help the retail. So we just had a prime land on this row, on next to our mall, which we actually had kept it for commercial. We converted into MLCP, added more 1,000 car park and 1,000 two-wheeler parking. So, you know, it helped the mall, it helped the retailers. We the moment the metro was coming in the city and there was a possibility to get connectivity, we spent the money and added the connectivity which benefited, where customers really came into the second floor of the mall. So it helped the whole retail in the second floor. So currently we are completed 5 years, we are renovating the entire mall at a budget of around 22 crore rupees. So my point is, it's also to ensure that we have retail in that mall, and it's a mixed-use development where we have a Marriott behind the mall. So it's also to ensure that Marriott, the customers coming to Marriott also feel that they're staying with us, and then entering the mall, they're entering the hotel. When they're entering the mall, they're entering a world-class mall. So all this is the vision, and we are now building more 11 malls in the country. So we have. So each of these malls, if they are the, so in a city, we're going to do a million square feet property of leasable area and a smaller property, which will be our hypermarket perspective. So wherever we are doing it, we want to make it a destination property. And we ensure that we partnering with retailers and we get unique, across the categories, we get unique brands so that then only the destination value will be added.
So, Shiva, this partnership is short-term or long-term? What's the lease term nowadays?
Our minimum short-term leases are of 5 years, and renewal terms are of 3 years, and our long-term leases are 9 years.
Okay. Raghu, on this, you know, you have been doing retail for so many years, and now you are wearing the hat, you know, on the development side. You have been involved in successful developments, you know, across the South India. Going forward, what are your views in terms of, you know, what would be the next in terms of the lease terms going forward? So will it be what's been happening right now, or you guys are thinking of revolutionizing the, you know, the way the game has to be played going forward?
I think as far as lease tenure is concerned, you have to give certain amount of time for a retailer to settle down and earn payback if it's too short. I think increasingly you're going to see more and more, I think, agreements, collaborative in nature, between the mall manager and the retailer in terms of what expectations to lay out and how those expectations will be fulfilled. I think that is what is going to determine. I'm not too worried about whether you want to give a 2-year lease, 5-year lease, it doesn't matter. There is some, see, below a certain threshold, the retailer cannot make money. And, you know, I've had this view for years, and I'm sure everybody here in the panel would second me. A developer makes money when a retailer makes money. It doesn't work any other way. So you have to allow the retailer to make money. The more money he makes, the more profitable it is for the mall. So I'm really not worried here. I mean, you give me 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, it doesn't matter. Because if you want to exit a retailer, you can exit gracefully and mutually. If a retailer wants to stay, you'll do it happily. So I'm not too fussed about this.
So Mr. Shah, on this, how are you seeing the fight for space in organized, you know, retail formats? for Indian brands versus the international brands?
I think as far as our requirement is concerned, we need approximately to open 40 stores. And I don't think malls are coming, 40 malls in the India, getting operational every year. So basically we look for standalone, where the high street is there. I consider that as an open mall, that's all. And basically we keep both the options open. Wherever the malls are good coming, we open their stores and we do high street, both we do. And looks like retail requirement is very high. And the basically retailer can't wait, they have to grow. So they will find out their way to grow. That is what is going to happen.
So do you see, no, so my question was, are you getting the first preference or the Uniqlos of the world are getting the first preference?
What you're saying?
Are you getting the first preference or the Uniqlos of the world are getting first preference?
Yeah, it's, it depends on mall owner to choose what is their catchment. If they are opening the store in Baroda or secondary city, and if they do international brand, there will be problem. It will not give the numbers, and that's what is happening. So it depends what mall owner wants to do. But I think keeping customer in the focus, there will be Indian brand which is more relevant, and that's what is going to happen. So it's difficult to say what is their choice. So if you see the many of the international players are not able to open more than 16, 17 stores all over the India. And we, as a Westside, we are in 73 cities with 132 stores. And this year we'll add another 40 stores. So I think we are more relevant. Let's see what happens. It's not, if we are not preferred, not preferred. It's okay.
Sanjeev,
it doesn't make any difference to us.
Sanjeev, is Mr. Shah preferred or not?
I think that would be incorrect to say whether it's preferred or not. I think he's a valuable part of the whole retail industry. I mean, he's one of, you know, the oldest people involved. I think Westside is our homegrown brand. Why is it that we need to run our own homegrown brands? I mean, there's no reason to. Of course, eventually, as Raghu says, the retailer has to make money. And that's how I make money. If that's the case, then the customer has to spend that money. And the customer has to decide, because he votes with his feet, eventually his wallet, but I didn't want to sound rude. So eventually he has to get in there and he has to make the sale. So if he's not going to do that for Westside, and the brand demands that I should have, I mean the customer demands that I should have Uniqlo there, then so be it. You know, we're not going to make bones about it. Nor is he, because he understands that eventually he also has to fulfill some commitments. So I think it is unfair to say, you know, whether it's a foreign brand or... And let me tell you, our brands that we produce, some of the clothes, produce for all the foreign brands. So, I mean, you know, it's a dichotomy. On one hand, you say, oh, we love the foreign brands, while our Indian producers and manufacturers are producing it for the foreign brands. And the moment they put their own label, you say, nay, nay, it doesn't sound right, so you're not going to enter my mall. So I think we need to be a little bit, you know.
Fair and balanced on that. So, Raghu.
I just want to add, to make a statement, we have a few stores what we have opened, like a Park Street or a Commercial Street or a Himayat Nagar. And that makes people to rethink about the brand. And that's what even we are representing in IRF, is basically to show how the change is happening. Basically, change is a constant, and that is what we are doing. As a brand, I don't think any brand is spending 50 to 60 crore to renovate the stores. We renovate 20 stores every year. I don't think anyone is doing that. So that's what we are doing it, and I think most of the places will be relevant. I know that.
Good to know on that, Raghu. You know, experience, so I think the mall space has been changing. It's no more about shopping. It's no more about, you know, going there and, you know, opening a wallet. As Sanjeev said, their wallets are just moving around in that mall. What is your opinion in terms of the experience centers now, which, you know, developers are trying to now develop and take it forward?
I think world over it's a phenomenon, and it'll come to India if it's not already come. Experience is going to play a key part. The worry I have is a mall can only create the right ambience, can make it easy for people to enter, exit, feel secure, have comfortable shopping environment and so on in a mall. But the core is the experience has to come from shopping and entertainment and F&B and the retail component of the mall. So to that extent, I think we are dependent on retailers. So I think what's going to happen is, if I put myself in the role of a developer, and I'm going to be more choosy about the kind of retail mix I have, because I also want to see who is anticipating, who is connecting with the new customer of today. Are they creating stores which are more experiential? I mean, for example, in Bangalore, Myntra have opened for one of their brands a new store with a phenomenal checkout. So it's basket based, it's immediate, there are no cash tills, nothing. So completely different experience. Okay, now are customers looking for things like that? Are they looking for assisted shopping? What? So I think different experiences for different customers. So I think my role as a developer, as a mall manager, will be to find the right blend and the mix. But I can take it up to a level. Beyond that, the retailer has to take it forward.
So Abhishek, taking from there, because if it's all about experience, how are you guys doing your pre-nuptial agreements with your retailers now? So you know what I mean, is how are you doing your leasing contracts with your retailers now? So that, you know, the experience remains there. The center doesn't, you know, gets affected because of bad experience. Because Raghu says purely it's now in the hands of retailers.
Well, to start with, you have to be careful and mindful of what you're bringing into the mall. Is it relevant to your catchment? Is it relevant to what the people want around you? Once you've done that, then the second other things that we now ask is, what is the kind of trading density one would do, the number of days of sales and things like that. So it's really about, like I said, collaboration and the whole running of the business and not just leasing out the shop. Plus, we also talk a lot about marketing and what initiatives of marketing the brand is willing to do. And the response has been great because everybody's willing to invest into marketing. Everybody's willing to engage with the customer more and more along with the mall. And we've seen that if you do it with the mall, the brand does it with the mall, it is just as much more effective. So it just works well.
Okay, interesting. So Lalit, can we see short-term leases from Spencer's now? Yeah. And what would short-term mean it from your side?
Short-term?
Leases for Spencer's now?
It's a completely irrelevant question to a hypermarket retailer.
So you know, if the customer experience, you know, so how do we take up the customer experience?
Yeah, so that's more relevant, I guess. So yeah, on experience front, you know, what I've understood in this industry is, or any industry for that matter, you know, so the principle that works is the grow core and then add more. Some people confuse it and they started adding so much more and forget the core. So you can't fiddle with the core and then believe that, you know, with a lot of new innovation or whatever XYZ will actually, you know, take you through. So for example, any customer is walking in a store to get a particular product. So if he want a paste or whatever XYZ, that is his priority. You know, that's what he is here for. Even if you create a Taj Mahal and then you do not have Colgate, what will he come for next time? So he won't. And that's exactly what happens, and I'm sure all of us have been to such stores. And you know, I can take an example of one of the stores in Tirupati I had gone to, and that day, the Tirupati had local elections. So the shops were shut. So this shop, which was, you know, four floors, 3,000 square feet each floor, and 12,000 square feet shop, and as if it was never been cleaned. You know, so it had, you know, this thick layer of, you know, dust or whatever. And the shop was shut. Only the staff entry was open from where the, you know, the small gate where the staff could enter. And there were almost 300 to 400 customers inside that shop. Okay, because you name the product and they had it. So you can talk about anything, any experience or anything that we discuss here. You know, what are the nice thing to do? You know, it has to be neat and clean and, you know, innovative light, this, that. There was nothing of, you know, any of those elements. And still the shop was buzzing, cash registers were ringing. Why it was happening? Because the core was intact. They had everything, and mind it, it was a full price shop. There was no discount on any product at all. There were only product and the customers. And everything else was missing. So I think, you know, so core is the key for any business's success, so is the retail. And I believe, you know, if we are able to handle that, rest of the thing, rest will come from the inefficiency. 10, 12 years in the hypermarket industry, my learning has been that we all started with a lot of inefficiency. And what we have achieved in last 10, 12 years is nothing much, but we have, you know, reduced those inefficiencies to a great extent and thereby, you know, making our format profitable. So what we were doing in, say, 40,000 square feet, we are doing in 20,000 square feet. If you see my masters, you know, master as in the SQ master that you have in the store, 10 years back, I have much greater or the larger master accommodated within the 20,000 square feet space. How did that happen? So it is largely on the back of efficiency. The supply chain has played a tremendous role in this. So is the developer, and so is the vendors. They also understand that, you know, how to you know, make this journey successful. So instead of supplying once in a week, they are supplying three times in a week, and thereby you are not unnecessarily investing money in, you know, carrying a lot of baggage. So those are the experiences that we believe will actually keep the customers with you and drive. I was telling somebody, my, you know, one of the stores, I don't want to name it, but the ABV of that store in a hypermarket business is 2100 rupees. Just imagine 2100 rupee ABV is, like, you know, unheard of. And not everybody is buying 2100 rupees. So a lot of people are buying 100, 200, 300. So it means there are a lot of customers who are buying 10,000, 12,000 rupees.
So Sanjeev, so, happy to have dusty stores in your flashy malls?
I don't think that's ever going to happen on my watch. I don't believe in that. I mean, why would you do that? I mean, that's just bizarre on so many levels. And just because he's a filthy guy and he makes the best pakoras, it doesn't mean I'm going to go and eat it there. You know, we just have to, I mean, these are now hygiene factors that are not discussable. But as he rightly said, I think the reason why there are 400 guys lining up outside that place, because there's no other guy doing it. If there was another guy who had kept it all clean and he had the same product, I don't think so, the guy would be going there. So I think let's not fool ourselves. I mean, Lalit may have a point that he might be trying to do that, but I don't think so that going forward that an organized retail setup is ever going to do that. I mean, you know, Shibu and the whole of Kerala, what they've been through has been just terrible, and, you know, we wish him all the best. And he has managed, and I was discussing with him and a lot of our friends out of Cochin and stuff like that, and they have managed to keep it pristine. You know, even they had got their basements flooded, am I right, Shibu? So I think kudos to all of these people who put it all together, and the people who are on the front line of keeping all our malls, you know, our security guards, our maintenance people and all. I mean, I would be questioned 100 times by Lalit himself, why it's not painted and why is there dust on the floor. So that is not going to work. But you know, the one thing I want to share with y'all, the retailers have made the developers extremely smart. And of course, we are coming from the retail side of things, so we brought those figures also. But today, all of the figures that we discussed with the retailers is because we are coming from retail, and, you know, there's no brigadiers and generals running malls. So, as I always say, that retail people running retail is very, very important. And what has happened is that when we are discussing them, we actually tell retailers that, no, you shouldn't be doing this at our mall, because we are coming with a lot of information. I think Shibu rightly said in the discussion before that, I know what I am talking about because I am there every day. So that is the experience now that we share with the retailers, and the retailers are so much more happy that we are able to advise that don't take this, you know, size of space, don't come in this place, trust me, you know your figures. So I think that interaction with the retailers and the developers has definitely made a huge impact. So, you know, 2008, as I say, is probably the best thing which happened to us, because it shook us out that, you know, we are not all this rosy and cozy. So this is the reason all this has happened.
So she was doing 11
just a second,
malls.
Man, just a second. Man. So Sanjeev, to answer your, you know, this thing. Yes, to answer your this. So I'm not advocating or not seconding that, you know, the keeping store dirty is making his sale. No. So point is that even if the store was dirty, it was selling because the core was intact. And obviously, if it was clean, probably it would have done even better. You know, so if all the other things that we discuss, if you did that, then probably it will do better. But then I'm saying that's not the make or break of for the store. Make and break for the store is actually the product and the customer. If these two things are there, rest of things will follow.
And I'll add another something to this is that we track the sales of most of the stores every month. So whenever we see a number going down, the first thing that we check is there enough material on the racks?
Yeah.
And 99% of the time we notice that there isn't enough material on the racks.
I think we track this also, and we are talking to the retailers why his sale is going down. In fact, August has, and then you go pan India, because now we can discuss with every what's happening everywhere else. Yeah. And I think August has been probably one of the worst months that we have seen. And then what is the reason? Because there's no reason. So, you know, there's so much studying that's going on. Acha, EOSS may, all you guys have started selling early. So now next time EOSS is coming around, we're telling the retail boss, you're only going to have 3 weeks. You're not going to, you know, bugger up my whole sale for the... So I think, see, this is where the game is. This is where the fun part is. I think, you know, this is a live space. And the fun part is actually working together on this.
Shibu, how are you planning for your 11 stores, 11 centers across country?
I think another important thing is that when you discuss with any developer, most of the people knows the numbers of your what you are doing in that city and what is your SVFs are there and everything. So it's, I think now the information is flowing very well and the decision-making process has become much simpler. It's not that retailer is in isolation and developers are in isolation. That's changing very fast.
Shibu, what is the change that you guys are predicting now? You know, doing 11 centers across country. How do you see this space changing, and what is the new thing that you guys are going to see in this space?
We clearly see that, you know, customers have not many reasons to come to a shopping mall. So some of the prime reasons for customers to come to a mall is entertainment and food and the hypermarket. And fashion, you know, being available at many places. And so it's a common brands, and there are some unique brands which might be present in one or two malls, which becomes the reason for them to travel to that. So earlier, fashion was occupying 70% of the mall space, and that's shrinking. And entertainment and food is taking more than 30%. We ourselves were earlier committing 50,000 carpet area for our entertainment. Now we are going ahead and committing 85,000 square feet area for entertainment. Because what happens with that type of space is we can offer everyone their space and different type of options for them. And that's one big change we're doing. Second big change we're doing is, you know, with respect to, you know, the offerings of food. We realize that, with the aggregators coming in like Swiggy and Uber, people also are using our spaces to order food. And so it's a big reason that, you know, people now, earlier people were going out two or three times in a week, but now people are ordering in every day also. So we really have to have, and now with a lot of entrepreneurs starting different type of cuisine, people trying out different type of cuisines, you know, so, you know, we need to have a good experience center, restaurants, then only people will actually come out. So food courts are going to shrink a little, but restaurants are going to be more in numbers.
So Sanjeev and Abhishek,
I have to say something. This is going to be the, I believe, the two greatest things which are going to happen. Food and Uber. Now, all our malls have to be designed for Uber and Swiggy. I'm you get the category. This is going to become one of the most important parts for our malls, which are going to be redesigned. So you have to have a back end now, which will ensure that the Uber in, Uber out, and getting an Uber, which they're already doing now in Thailand, in Manila, and all these places. They're already doing it. And a whole section for delivery. So Spencer's delivery, Swiggy delivery, all of these. Now bike parkings have to start for all of those to happen. That is going to be one critical change in the kind of design element we do, because it's otherwise it's becoming a mess. And second big thing is food now becoming as in gourmet style, but in a food court. So these are the things we are watching, how people now want to enjoy food, because social media has become such an important part of everyone's life. Short of going to the toilet and photographing yourself, leaving that, they are, you know, doing selfies everywhere. And food, of course, is absolutely fantastic. So I believe that each center, which is going to be a differentiating center, is how they're going to position and present food. And I think that is going to be a very big game changer.
The food court design is changing now. I'm sure that you'll be noticing that if you go to restaurants, you can see kitchens. You can see the kitchen preparing your food live. In the sense, live, and but you can also see through the kitchen because it's glass and you can see chefs working inside. That's the change we are now making our retailers do in the food court. Because what happens is everyone is questioning the hygiene in the food court because they are small, 250 square feet, 300 square feet, cramped space. So we are telling our retailers to actually see it, make them see it through, and so that customers feel really glad in that. Swiggy is something, we do an average of around 360 to 370 orders, and we really saw that, there were a lot of buzz happening. So as rightly said, Sanjeev, that we need to now, in the new malls, all these have been taken care. Uber drop-ins and Ola drop-ins are taken care so that they can come in, drop, and move out. So these are a lot of these convenience, ingress and egress for the customers are, you need to really provide them that.
So definitely Uber and Swiggy are here to stay. Abhishek, is Swiggy taking out money out of your pocket or you're capturing in your contracts?
To answer that, I think I'll just give you one figure. Even if I keep aside my home delivery, which Swiggy or anybody else is doing, my F&B has grown by 35% last year to this year. So it's clearly an indicator that because pizza is being delivered at home doesn't mean people are not having pizza in the mall. So okay. there's no connection.
And on the other side, Mr. Shah, is apparel being threatened with food and entertainment taking the key space of the malls? So no more apparel is needed?
It increases the footfall at my place.
He's going to create more food at West Side. Yeah.
So now West Side is going to be a food West Side.
It must.
So I think we have to see benefit out of it and not the threat.
Sandeep,
I'm present in a Lulu mall, where it's a benefit to me, as simple as that. And for your information, he has not added, but he has run buses to get the customer from 60 kilometer, free buses. And that's many people have not done that. So his catchment, it's not the mall as a catchment of 10 to 12 kilometer, it's a 60 kilometer.
It's about bringing in the customers. So Sanjeev, where do you see the future for consultants in this space?
Consultants?
Yeah.
I think that was answered by Shibu, but so a consultant is a consultant.
Okay.
Eventually the decision is going to be ours, and they are going to paint the best rosy pictures of why a brand should exist in your space. However, you are the decider. And the consultant is not running your business, you have to run it. So every month if the sale is not taking place, then the upper management is going to say that let's remove you and appoint the consultant. So I think one has to understand very clearly that as I see this now happening in India, where the big groups are starting to make formidable asset space in the retail area, as one would say. So you have the Phoenix, you have Lulu, and all of them now, Pacific, I don't know, he's going to make 20 malls. So the point is that all of them are already on board as far as the retailers' one-to-one interaction is concerned. At some stage, I don't see that the consultant is really going to help as far as that is concerned. I think value addition is of what you can add. If when a person is going to make a mall, I think that becomes very, very important. Is this the right space? You know, what would they be thinking? I think that's the kind of thing. But deal making, I don't know how long, if this is the trend, it continues.
So brokers are out of job here. You're scaring the brokers.
I'm not going to say that brokers are going to be out of job. I think the most important thing first to understand is there are no brands in India. And I have been saying this for the last like 5-6 years that, you know, every mall, we have the same brands. For God's sake, you know, look at Thailand. That's a one city country. Yeah? They've got every brand in the world. And how many people consume? Yeah, Bombay, Delhi, everybody. I don't think we are, I know you, kaleja nahi hai to bring all these guys in or whatever. I think the consultants are not doing their job. You know, you guys should be telling all these people that bring these 100 brands. I mean, Mr. Shah should be bringing 100 brands. They're the Tatas of the world. They've got one Starbucks and they've got Westside and, you know. But I really believe that until the brands, all of them don't come in, till then you have a great time because you have an opportunity. But please don't bring 2 brands every year and then keep your job. Bring 200. No, Zara's.
So Mr. Shah, how many brands are you going to bring now?
So Sanjeev, that's it. So the whole conversation ends now at the retail forum because Zara is here. I'm sure there's more to retail than Zara is, you know. All developers go completely mad. Zara, Zara. The whole city goes mad. Zara.
The most beautiful
what was
brand.
There? Nobody was wearing clothes before.
So Mr. Shah, what's the promise for how many brands next year?
I don't think we will grow our own brand. That's a concept. We are not going to bring the brands from, basically, from abroad.
Shibu, what are you guys now? Because I understand you guys also are getting a lot of international brands. How many brands that you guys are thinking of adding and what's the rollout for that? At least, you know, give some comfort to Sanjeev that at least around 100 brands.
So we are committed to that and because we are developing malls, many more malls and we really see that then becomes a differentiator for us. So our sister concern, Tables, is getting a lot of brands and I think in the next couple of years, 10 more brands will be added into it. So you will keep hearing from us every couple of months. So as we talk, there's a lot of discussions happening for some good brands actually.
Okay. Interesting to know. Abhishek?
Other thing, if you look at in hypermarket, we used to do something like 60,000, 70,000 square feet. Now, we have a concept where we do the star market at 8 to 10,000 square feet. And we are operating at something like 20 to 25,000 square feet. And some of the places we get even 50,000 SPF. So we are reducing the hypermarket size. And that's how, if we are in the mall, then they save the space. So basically it's working. We keep only food, it works at 7,000 square feet. So they can give it to the F&B, remaining space.
Absolutely, Radha. You know, I would say the shortage of space is a good problem to have than, you know, having more space. So, yeah. But I'm not returning you.
Abhishek, what's your view after Zara? Who's going to, you know, help us?
For the benefit of the panel, I think Westside.
So let's not be biased to So interesting, guys. I think so going forward, you know, it's a industry going in the right direction. We're seeing a lot of partnership. Luckily, the times have changed from, you know, 2002 to 2008. You know, it's no more about, you know, me and you. It's no more about the retailer or the developer. I think so it's more about partnership and then trying to pick the wallet out of the customer. With that, I would like to thank you, the panel, and then open the forum for any questions. The gentleman over there, that side, you want the mic? Oh, we're done. Everybody's so tired about, you know, the 2 days. So, yeah, Mr. Sen. So Sanjeev, you are going to answer it, or Lalit is going to answer that?
It's a group question.
So imagine, or it's a group answer, you know, to the boss.
No, it's nice to hear that, you know, we are making collaborative attempt rather than competitive attempt, that you against me or you together with me. But this online and offline, you see, there is a huge opportunity when you talk about efficient utilization of space, that you use a hypermarket or any store as a distribution center for online retail. But the dichotomy here is that the offline retailer, they feel their online sale is not from the mall. So why a mall should make an investment either for Uber or for Ola or for bikers if you don't share the online retail revenue also with the developer? That's a problem that is occurring all over India, and Lalit, you know it well. I don't know who else doesn't know it. But I would like the panel to answer. If you expect the developer to invest heavily or adequately, I will not take sell heavily, but adequately, onto helping you to develop your online component from an offline retail, utilizing it as a distribution center, then the kind of thing you do to the particular development, the mall, don't you think the mall management, if they want to cooperate with you really wholeheartedly, they should have also a slice of cake from there? That's my question to the panel.
Thank you, Mr. Sen.
There's something I want to add to that question also is, and a concern, is that I see a lot of times retailers are promoting their online portals in my outlet, in my mall. So they will, yeah. So that becomes, the problem escalates. As long as the revenue is being shared with the developer, it's fine. But yeah, but you are promoting your online portal in my shop and then not giving me the sale for it. So that actually amplifies the problem a little bit more.
So Shibu, I don't think so, your promoter's here, and probably you can answer this.
Shibu ka to ek pocket se dusre pocket mein ja raha hai.
Okay, I have this, but anyway, but so I'm in the same boat as you are, sir, and our constant dialogue with the retailer is that if anything is happening, if any sales is developing from the mall, but obviously in your offline retail, and if it happens in the mall, or if the delivery is happening in the mall, then we need to be having part of it. So that's a very clear discussion with any retailer. But as you rightly said, we are investing heavily and we're making everything right. So they need to definitely pay for it. And I'm sure that, you know, we traveled this long journey and we reached this table where we are sitting and saying consensus has happened. I'm sure that will also happen very soon.
Also, this is a very early days between this. So I think there's a lot of learning. There's going to be a little burning, but there's going to be learning.
So you still feel the fair play in the industry is not there for this? Abhishek, how are you going to think of capturing this? Eventually, you want the buck.
I mean, we'll have to learn how to capture this. We're still learning. It's too soon to say what's going to happen. We didn't think about it. Just 2 years ago, we didn't know that there'll be a concept of click and pay. So how do we know what's going to happen 1 year from now or 2 years from now? It's really difficult to imagine. The only way this can work is that whenever something new happens, both of us sit together and figure out a way that it's a win-win situation for both.
But these questions are now asked when we do lease. What is your pricing policy? Is there a differential pricing policy for online? So there are very clear questions asked, and before choosing whether we should give space to this retail or that retail. We clearly look that as a parameter now.
Great. So the learning curves goes. Probably one last question from the audience. Are we done? So thank you. Thank you, you know, for taking time out.